Good morning.
Good morning.
Get things set up. Take your Bibles and open them up to 1 Peter. Told you that this book, if there was one book in all Scripture that could give you everything you needed for salvation, this little letter that Peter wrote would fit. It would give you everything you needed to know about God, about His Son, Jesus Christ, about how you should live as a Christian, about what to expect as a follower of Jesus Christ. Everything that Peter writes here is so full of meaning. I'd like to do a little review before we get started. Turn with me to 1 Peter chapter 1 to see how all this fits together. Peter says in verse 1, who he is, that he is Peter. He's an apostle of Jesus Christ. And then he tells you who this is written for. But it's also not just for those followers of Jesus in Peter's day, but it has been kept so that we too can receive the same message. Because this is a message that will be in effect until Christ comes back. So it is for all believers in all times. Look at verse 3. Peter tells you who he is, who he's writing to. He's writing to followers of Jesus Christ. He blesses them, grace to you, and peace be multiplied. And then he blesses God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again to a living hope. Peter lays out right from the beginning what God has done for us. He has taken us out of this world, and he has raised us up to not a dead hope, but a living hope, because we serve a living Savior. Amen. Now, Peter is preparing his hearers for persecution, that it will come, and they need to know how to deal with it when it comes. And he wants them to know that, like James, that it's not some strange thing that's happening to you, but this is a part of God's plan. That's hard for believers to understand. But let me ask you a question. Who did the devil have to ask permission of before he could touch Job's family? And when that didn't work, who did he have to ask permission before he could touch his body? You guys understand that? The devil can do nothing to you unless God allows it. Which means God allows it. And you have to understand that God, in His love, will allow these things to happen. He doesn't cause them to happen, but He allows them to happen. Do you understand the difference between those two? If God was to protect you and I and all the believers from every bad thing that would happen, how would we ever change? What would we have to look forward to? If you didn't suffer in this life, then this life would be pretty great, wouldn't it? Right? Think about that. God tells you plainly that this is not your home. There's a better home. But in this life, Jesus said, if you follow me, you will have trials and persecutions. Okay? So, this is what's happening in the lives of those that Peter is writing to. And he's preparing them. He's not telling them that it's not going to happen. He's telling them this will happen, and this is the mindset that you must have. Excuse me. So he tells them that they have been given a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. They've been given an inheritance in verse 4 that's incorruptible and undefiled, and that does not fade away, and it is reserved for them in heaven until they get there. Think about that. It is a bank account that is always full, that you can never drain, and it is reserved with your name on it. And in verse 5, he says, you are kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in when? Now, I want you to understand, when Peter wrote this, did he believe it was the last time? Right? I guess that's what he said in the last time. Paul gives you the same idea as well when he writes. John in the book of Revelation gives you the same idea. But was that the last days? Sure it was for them. Right? I told you before, you're going to meet Jesus in one of two ways. You're going to meet him when he comes in the sky, or you will meet him in death. Either way, the outcome will be the same. Right? So when he says it's the last days, was it the last days for them? Yes, it was the last days. If Jesus decides to tarry for another 50 years, there will be many of you who these are your last days. Right? This is why we need to live as if Jesus was coming tomorrow. Today, the next minute. Right? And be ready so that it doesn't take us by surprise, because you do not know what tomorrow is going to be, if you have a tomorrow. Okay, so that's verse 1, or chapter 1. Then he starts to tell them what is going to happen in verse 6. In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, if need be, you have been grieved by various trials. Right? So he's preparing them. And he's telling them that trials are a necessary part of your walk with God. But listen, he also tells you that you don't walk this alone. That there is one that has walked before you, he walks with you, and he'll carry you through. Right? Who is that one? Right? Okay. So he's preparing them. He's letting them know that they have a foundation in Jesus Christ and a hope that cannot be taken away. They have an inheritance that's incorruptible and, again, cannot be taken away. Let's look at chapter 1, verse 18. Ray, can you read that for me? Verse 18.
For as much as ye know that ye were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold, from your vain conversation received by traditions from your fathers.
Verse 19.
But with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot.
So how are we redeemed? What makes our redemption so sure? Our redemption is so sure because we have been redeemed not by corruptible things, but by something that is incorruptible, cannot be touched by the sinfulness of this world, and that is the blood of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And if the blood of Jesus Christ is covering you, that means you cannot be touched by the wickedness or the evil in this world. Right?
Amen.
You have been given an incorruptible inheritance. Why do we celebrate communion? Why do we do foot washing? Because even though you have an incorruptible inheritance, you step in stuff in this world, right? And so the communion service, the foot washing service, is a time of washing, of regeneration. But you only need to wash the feet if you're covered by the blood of Jesus. Is that right? That's what Jesus said to Peter. So do you think Peter lays out a good foundation of how we're saved, why we're saved, and why we can have such faith in our salvation?
Yeah.
Right? Who does he lay out as that salvation? Jesus Christ, right? So that's what chapter 1 is about. That when trials come your way, realize that you have a firm foundation, if you built upon him, that will hold forever, and nothing can shake you from that. Verse 22 of chapter 1, since you have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit, in what? That is how you know if you're obeying the truth, if you have sincere love for the brethren. Love one another fervently and with a pure heart. Doing this, you do this because you have been born again. And if you are born again, then that will come to you naturally. Right? Because you have the Holy Spirit working in your life. You are no longer controlled by your own lusts and your own wants and the wickedness of the fallen flesh. But you have been born again, and the Spirit lives in you, and now you can love the brethren fervently. With what kind of heart? A pure, sincere heart. Now, how many of you have ever dealt with people who were insincere and did not have a pure heart? Who you thought they loved you, but you find out that they didn't. That is a pain that is hard to ever forget, right? You don't ever have to worry about that with Jesus Christ. And you should not have to worry about that from your brethren in the church. Okay? Let's look at chapter 2. How do we love each other fervently with a pure heart? By laying aside all malice, all deceit, all hypocrisy, all envy, and all evil speaking. And as newborn babes, we desire the pure milk of the word that we may grow thereby. If indeed you have tasted that the Lord is gracious, coming to him as to a living stone, rejected by men, but chosen by God and precious. So chapter 2 tells you who you are in Christ. You are a new creation. You're a royal priesthood. You're a chosen generation. You are God's representatives here on this earth. That when the world wants to see who God is, when they want to know who Jesus is, they should be able to see you and see Jesus. They should be able to look at how you treat each other in the church, and that should draw them into the church. Amen. Why is it that you can go to a bar and it's packed? And you come to church and there are empty pews. Now, I know there's nobody here that in your earlier lives ever went to bars, right?
Amen.
Do you know why the bars are packed? Because there's fellowship in the bars. And the people sitting next to you are just like you. You know them, they know you. I had a friend of mine tell me I'd much rather deal with a worldly person, somebody sitting next to me in the bar, because I know who they are, than the Christian, because I really don't know who they are. And, you know, they smile in my face, and then they stab me in the back. Ooh. Love the brethren fervently, and that's what shows the world that you truly are Christ's. This is why I love this church. Are we perfect?
No.
But do we love each other? Yes. When people come in, are they able to see that? And the answer is yes. And because of that, the devil will try to split the fellowship here and will bring in. Isn't it amazing that it's small things that the devil uses to bring dissension within the people? Pettiness. Just small, tiny things. Jealousies, envies, all those things that Peter said to give up. And what does he tell us to do? Instead of looking at each other's faults, number one, be a fervent student of the Word of God. Okay? And that if you take, now he's telling them as babes. Now what I'm hoping here is that the preaching that you hear here will not keep you in that state. That you are able to move from the milk and go to the meat that Paul talks about. Okay? But you need to start with the milk. And sometimes we have to go back to the milk. But that's not where you want to stay. You want to be true students of the Word of God. That you grow from grace to grace. That your knowledge increases. Not to give you pride, but it should bring humility to you because you get to see Jesus in a clearer and clearer light. And the clearer you see Him, the clearer you see yourself. And that should only bring humility. Right? So, Peter goes on. Let's look at verse 22. Since you have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit in sincere love of the brethren, love one another fervently with a pure heart, having been born again, not of corruptible seed, which your mother and your father gave you, but incorruptible, which is what God the Father has given you, through the Word of God, which lives and abides forever. That was chapter 1, sorry. In chapter 2, he goes on to say in let's look at verse 5. You also are what?
Living stones.
Living stones. You're being built up into a spiritual what? House. You're a holy priesthood. You're able to offer up spiritual sacrifices that are acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. Do you understand what this means and who you are? Prior to Christ coming and his death on the cross, they went to the temple and they had to go to the earthly priest to offer sacrifices that were acceptable to God. But now Peter is telling them that you're able to do that yourselves. You don't need an earthly mediator because you have a heavenly mediator. And that you no longer need to go to the earthly sanctuary. You yourselves are a sanctuary that God will live inside of you. Let me tell you, when the Jews heard this, that didn't accept Jesus, they would stone you for that. Do you guys understand that? They could not grasp that, and they thought it would be blasphemy. Do you understand what God has done for you? When He makes you new, He makes you new. You are no longer that same person. Let's look at verse 9 of chapter 2. Peter goes on, and he tells you now that you are a what? A chosen generation. And he doesn't stop there, but you're also a what? A royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of Him who called you out of darkness into His marvelous light. Let's look at verse 11. Beloved, I beg you as sojourners and pilgrims. What's a sojourner and what's a pilgrim?
A traveler.
A traveler, right? Someone who hasn't set down roots. This is not your home. Don't get too comfortable here. Because you are travelers and pilgrims, Peter begs you to do what? What does that word abstain mean? Avoid. Don't mess with. Stay away from. What are you supposed to stay away from? Now, what are fleshly lusts?
Everything you do.
Everything you do. Now listen, it's everything you do in the flesh compared to how you should live in the Spirit. Right? The difference between the carnal nature and the spiritual nature. Now, how many natures do you have in you? Two, right? If you're not a follower of Jesus, you only have one. And you have a carnal nature, right? But when you accept Jesus Christ, you now have two natures. You still have this fleshly, fallen, carnal nature. But Christ has made you into a new creation. Well, guess what? You know what that means? That means that the new creation is warring against the old creation, and the old creation is warring against the new creation. Yeah. So you will fight a battle every day. And what happens with us is we grow tired of fighting. But should we? It all depends on whether you see Jesus every day when you open your eyes. Is that who you focus on? Or do you focus on this world? Because if you focus on this world, your circumstances, the good or the bad things of this world, then you will fall to those fleshly lusts. But if you wake up and you see Jesus, and you focus on Him, and you see Him, and you say, Jesus, I want to live for You today, then you will not fall to those fleshly lusts. You will have the power to abstain from them. Now, why would Peter write that, I beg you? What does that word beg mean?
Plead.
Plead. Is there any stronger word that he could use? I am pleading, I am begging, please don't do this. If you had no power not to not do that, would he say that? So hence, if he's saying, I beg you, which means, yes, you have power over this in Christ, right? The problem is that we don't exercise that power. I have a dog at the house. It's called a Valley Bulldog. It is a mixture between a purebred boxer and a purebred English Bulldog. So what you're hoping to get is as much of the English Bulldog look without all the health problems. And you get what I got. What I got was the temperament of the Bulldog, the personality of the Bulldog, the aggressiveness of the Bulldog, with very little of the boxer, except for taller legs and a smaller head. Now this dog will eat anything that you put in front of him. This dog will knock you down if you drop something on the floor in front of him. And I'm not kidding you. When you feed this dog, you don't feed him with the piece of food in your fingers. You put it in the palm of your hand. Do you know why? Because the fingers and the teeth, the palm of your hand, you just get the gums. Okay? This dog's appetite is so voracious that I have to make sure I know what he eats and keep him from being able to access anything else. Which means all food has to be put up higher than what his little piggy paws can reach. Because what now he's a smart dog. Okay? Because I feed him and I feed the other little dog we have at the same time. And the other little dog only eats the wet food and doesn't eat the dry food. So she leaves the little bit of dry food. Now, the bulldog will wait for me to go in and brush my teeth. He'll lay down like he's the most perfect dog in the world. But he's listening for you. And as soon as that bathroom door closes, he's up there and you can hear him in that dish. And he will inhale that food as quick as possible. Okay? That is the same thing we do when we fall prey to these fleshly lusts, right? And we say we have no control over it, right? We have a number of justifications for our sinning, but in the end, turn with me to James. Let's look at chapter 1. A little bit further into James. James chapter 1, James says the same thing that Peter says, only he doesn't go through a whole chapter to tell them persecutions and trials are coming. James, after he says who he is, gets right to the core of his message. Okay? Verse 2, my brethren, count it all. What?
Joy.
Now I have looked in as many versions as I could because I think James wrote this wrong. It's one word. I think he messed up there. But I haven't found another word that doesn't mean joy or happiness or anything like that, right?
Well, how do you build spiritual muscle?
You gotta work it out, hey?
That's what he's talking about here. This is beautiful. I mean, I can see it.
What does James say? Count it all joy when you fall into what? Various trials. And this is why you count it joy. Not because God is sadistic, not because God doesn't like you, but because God loves you so much that He will allow pain to come in your life so that you can build your faith. Right? Let's look at what James says. Count it all joy when you fall into various trials. Verse 3. Knowing that the what?
Testing.
The testing of your faith produces what?
Patience.
Now, how many of you have enough patience? Raise your hand. Good. You probably don't go through the trials that I go through. Why? Because I need more patience. You know what I'm saying? The worst prayer you could ever pray?
Yep.
Lord, give me patience. Because you're hoping for, you know, the Disney magic wand thing. Never happens that way. So when you pray for patience, what happens? Things that cause you to be impatient comes across your path. Why did that happen? So that you can learn patience. And so you can see just how impatient you really are. Okay? The testing of your faith produces patience. But let patience have its what? Perfect work. What perfect work does it do? You may be perfect and complete, lacking what?
Nothing.
And what gives you this perfect completeness, this lacking of nothing? It is the various trials that you go through, which is why you need to count it all joy, because God loves you so much that He will allow this to happen so that you can be perfect, complete in everything. What does this word perfect mean?
Mature.
Mature. Yeah. Mature and complete. Right? Mature. This is the problem with faith today. Christianity is a mile wide and an inch deep. Think about this. I'm talking about all Christianity, every flavor of church you can think about. The problem with Christianity today is we are a mile wide and we are an inch deep. We have no roots. And when the sun comes up and it starts to get really hot, what happens? We fall away. We question God. We don't believe in Him anymore. Let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to how many? He gives to all liberally and without reproach, and it will be given to him. But there's a condition, right? There's a condition. What's the condition? You find that in the next two verses. But let him ask in faith with what? Okay, so, you know, I used to have a lot of friends that were in the wealth, what do they call it? The prosperity gospel movement, okay? So, I really need a lot more money in my bank account. And so, if I have enough faith, will God put 100?